Christ, you are flawless because of Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for this opportunity to celebrate communion again and to realize that the reason that we can take communion is because your Son Jesus has made us flawless through the cross. And we thank you for that cross this morning. And as we meditate for a few moments and as we take these elements, may we always remember that we are flawless in Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Flawless, having no defects or faults, especially none that diminished the value of something legally sound. The prosecution had a flawless case without one flaw or defect. It may seem minuscule to you, but growing up, I thought about flawless things in regards to cars. I loved cars in high school. I had my own Camaro, and I waxed it literally every day. You could see yourself a block away on my paint finish. People would come by who I didn't even know and say, "Are you waxing that thing again?" And I'd say to them, "Who are you? I don't even know your name." They say, "We see you wax your car all the time." Well, there is someone worse than me in my church. It's always in the church that you find these people. And this particular guy, he had a 79 burnt orange Pontiac Trans Am. It was gorgeous. It was flawless, if I could just dream for a moment. And he kept it in great shape. He'd shampoo the engine almost every week. He had this girlfriend, and they would come, and she had white bucket seats inside, and they were never dirty. As a matter of fact, when she sat in the car, he'd make her take her shoes off. He would put slippers on her feet. He would take her shoes, and he would put them in a bag, and then he'd put them in the trunk. This guy was extreme. And ultimately, weather or maybe an accident would have gotten this car, but no, it burned up in a fire in a warehouse. But this car was flawless. It was unbelievable. Today we talk about something that is far superior to any Trans Am, and that's Jesus Christ and what he's done for us on the cross. And if you know Jesus as your Savior, then you are flawless in the sight of the Father because of Jesus Christ. In the book of Hebrews, over and over again, Jesus is seen as superior or flawless to those earthly priests that went before him. In chapter 8, he mentions the basis of the better or the flawless covenant. Chapter 9, he ministers in a better or flawless place. In chapter 10, he is superior or flawless to the old priests and their unflawed or their flawful sacrifice. Not flawful, I think that made a new word. Anyway, three P's to this time before we take communion. And that is number one, he is a flawless priest. Verses 1 and 2. Hebrews chapter 8, if you have your Bibles, turn there. Paul is dealing with a group of Christians in a church that wanted to go back to the old way. They felt somehow that the old way was good enough, and yet it wasn't. Everything about the law was wrong. It wasn't enough, is what I'm trying to say. And we see here the contrast between this new priest, Jesus Christ, and the old priests under the law. Verses 1 and 2 of chapter 8 say, "Now the main point of what we are saying is this. We do have such a high priest who sat at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven, and who serves in the sanctuary, the true tabernacle, set up by the Lord, not by a mere human being. When Moses came down from the mount, he had instructions. He says, God says, I want you to put into the sanctuary like this, to make it so this is what you are to worship in. In chapter 7, Paul begins to talk about this new priest, this better priest, out of the order of Melchizedek. If you've done any homework on that, you know Melchizedek was a very special king who even Abraham paid a tithe to. In verses 11 to 17 in chapter 7, he goes on to talk about this superior high priest, the coming one, Christ. And that he truly was not of the order of Aaron, the old, but he was of the new order of Melchizedek. And we see here that Jesus Christ, number one, is morally perfect. Hebrews 7, 26 to 27. When the priests went into the holy place, they had to make sacrifices not only for the people, but for themselves. And yet Jesus Christ says, need make no sacrifice for himself. says, such a high priest truly meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. That's why we do not need to think that every time we have communion that Jesus is crucified again and is given his body. It's once and for all. That was how good his sacrifice was. He is sinless, even though we are sinful. And I don't know if there's a picture of me up here, but recently I was painting, and Della said, hey, you know, we need to take down that sunshine box in the kitchen. And of course, when we do things like that, it starts to yellow. And I have a picture of me, and I was painting the ceiling, and you know, me and painting are like me and mechanics. It's not a good mixture. And I'm painting away, and I'm thinking I'm doing a great job, and I'm put a coat on, and I'm really rubbing it on, and I don't know anything's happening. All of a sudden, through our French door, Della begins to laugh. And I'm thinking, what are you laughing at? So I stopped painting. I said, what's up? She says, you should see your face. It's like, you're totally covered. And I didn't know that. And it stuck. And so you can imagine, that's the first shot of three coats. So two more coats later, my face is just, my hair was white, my face, and I didn't know it. It stuck to me big time. Now, they had sold us some oil-based paint. And once again, I don't know about paint. And here I am with the water, and I'm scrubbing and scrubbing. It's not coming off. And I'm starting to panic. I'm saying, Della, look how old I look. My hair is totally gray or white. And she said, well, you need some paint thinner. And so we began to rub, and I think I must have taken off at least two or three layers, which probably needed to come off anyway. Yeah. And if I look a little more mature these days, it's not because I'm graying, it's because of the ceiling paint. First Peter 2:20, Peter tells us that he committed no sin and no deceit was found in his mouth. First John 3:5, but you know he appeared so that he might take away our sins, and in him no sin. Somehow Jesus Christ went to the cross, and the sin of the world did not stick to him. He did not need spiritual paint thinner to take it off. But yet, he died for our sins, and the sacrifice was complete. And yet, he's able to relate to us because of his 33 years on this earth. We have the best of both worlds. No Old Testament priest could understand what somebody was going through that was in the nation of Israel. But this priest, Jesus Christ, the superior priest, the flawless one, understands, and yet has not sinned. So he completes his task. Verse 1, it says that he is seated down at the right hand of the throne of majesty. Now in the temple there were no chairs because the priest's job was never done. There's always a new sacrifice for the people. And yet we see here that the blood of animals did not wash away or cleanse the guilty conscience. It's important to know that Jesus not only covered our sins, but he took them away. So he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and this is important as to where he is seated. We'll talk about that later. Only kings have thrones, not angels. Jesus is not an angel. Jesus is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. Psalm 110:1, the Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for you. Hebrews 1:3, the Son has provided perfection for all sins. He sat down at the right hand of the majesty in heaven. Jesus is so confident that he announced it from the cross. John 19:30, and when he had received the drink, he said, it is finished. Tetelestai. And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. He finished the job for dying for our sins. And his blood was a substitute for ours. Our salvation is based on one person and one person alone. And that's Jesus Christ. John 5:39 to 40, Jesus speaks to the religious leaders and says, look, you study the scriptures diligently, but in them you do not know that I am the one as to who the scriptures testify to. Hebrews 9:28, so Christ was crucified, was sacrificed once to take away the sins of all. We have a flawless priest. The second thing we see here is that it's accomplished in a flawless place. 3-5. Every high priest is appointed to offer both gifts and sacrifices, so that it was necessary for this one also to have something to offer. If he were on earth, he would not be a priest, for there are already priests who offer the gifts prescribed by the law. They serve at a sanctuary that is a copy and a shadow of what is in heaven. This is why Moses was warned when he was about to build the tabernacle, "See to it that you make everything according to the pattern shown you on the mountain." You know, oftentimes a place is so important. I mean, I think of places in the world I would love to be, Hawaii. I've never been to Mexico, or, you know, such nice places in the world. Places are important to us, but there's no more important place than where Jesus is in regards to being our Savior, and that's heaven. Now, there's a temptation on the part of the readers here to go back to the Old Testament, as I mentioned before. And you think, shake your head, like, that's unbelievable. Why would you want to go back to this when you can have the real thing? And then they would ask the question, well, how do I know that Jesus is ministering in heaven? And here we see that it's really important. Location, location, location. While the earthly priesthood of the Jews, our high priest Jesus, offers his sacrifice in heaven. The appointed place is not the earthly sanctuary. As a matter of fact, the scripture says Jesus wouldn't qualify because he was from the wrong tribe. He was from the tribe of Judah, the better tribe. Verse 5, we see that you make everything according to the pattern shown on the mountain. It's very important that this pattern be followed so that people get a glimpse of what eternity would be like. And like Lisa said today, one day Christ will come back and he'll take us to be with him in heaven. Hebrews 5:1 says that every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. But Jesus Christ is far superior to any earthly priest, and thus he is seated at the right hand of the Father in heaven. A flawless sacrifice on our behalf. We need not do anything but simply accept that free gift of flawlessness. Hebrews 8:3 points out one event for forgiving all, one time. And the word there, is something or somewhat, is a Greek word, and it means that one-time act. That's when we ask Jesus in our heart. We only need to ask him once. It takes. Jesus only had to die once on the cross so that all of our sins would be forgiven. So Christ was sacrificed once to take away our sins. Hebrews 9:28 says. In other words, our Lord is a living sacrifice in heaven. But he's not offering sacrifices in heaven. He is our living sacrifice. One time. That was all that was needed. And it wasn't because he was lucky. Because he was good. Very good. Flawless. So when people say, I can't come to this table because I have sin in my life, that's an excuse. Because it's not what you do to come here. It's what he's done to allow you to come. That's why it's important as you come before the communion to examine yourself. Because Jesus has done the heavy work. You simply need to acknowledge that in your life. So yes, he was from the tribe of Judah and not Levi. After all, I'm not sure I want to be associated with a tribe that made jeans. But anyway, so we see here that he is the promised Messiah. 5, the earthly sanctuary is only a typology of a heavenly sanctuary. Typology, of course, is a type or a picture of a New Testament truth. The pattern was to be followed, but he was the one who completed it. No flaws for now or for eternity. Someone stated that to go back to the Old Testament earthly temple would be like living on a blueprint as opposed to living in the building itself. But yet, there are many people today who want to live under works. Try to be good enough. It won't work. It's only through grace. The grace of Christ. Hebrews 10:1 says, the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the reality themselves. For this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifice repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. The last thing we see here is the last P is promises. It means flawless promises, 6 to 13. But in fact, the ministry Jesus has received is superior to theirs, as the covenant of which he is mediator is superior to the old one, since the new covenant is established on better promises. For if there had been nothing wrong with the first covenant, no place would have been sought for any for another. But God found fault with the people and said, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them from by the hand and led them out of Egypt, because they did not remain faithful to my covenant, and I turned away from them, declares the Lord." Verse 10, "This is the covenant I will establish with the people of Israel. After that time, declares the Lord, I will put my laws in their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they will be my people. No longer will they teach their neighbors or say to one another, 'Know the Lord,' because they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. For I will forgive their wickedness and remember their sins no more. By calling this covenant new, he has made the first one obsolete. And what is obsolete and outdated will soon disappear." The last couple of days, I don't know about you, but I was looking in the flyers, getting a good deal. Black Friday. What used to be a total disaster has become a shopping holiday. Everybody's looking for a deal. Something better. Upgrading, so to speak. For us, we see that we, when we come to Jesus, upgrade for eternity. The flawless promises are four in this last. 7 to 9, the promises of God's grace. If you notice in verse 7, he says, "I," versus the people, "we will." God becomes personally involved in this grace, and he gives us what we do not deserve. And God, through his grace, God's riches at Christ's expense, allows us to experience the things of love. And God, his attitude towards Israel, even after all those things, he says, talking to the obstinate nation of Israel, "Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. Therefore he will rise up to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him." Hebrews 4:16. When we sin, we have a place to go. "Let us therefore approach his throne of grace." Wow, what a deal we've gotten. What an upgrade God has given us through Christ over the old covenant. The new one we see here is awesome. The second thing we see here is a promise of eternal change. Verse 10, "No longer is it the outward, it's the inward, that the Holy Spirit comes into us. And the new covenant is that we begin to change from the inside out. And as we change from the inside out, people begin to see a change in us, and we see a change in ourselves. No longer wanting to go to the left, but leaning to the right. Wondering, what's God will in this? What would God want me to do? And thus there is a change inside of us through the Holy Spirit, the new nature that we receive only in Christ. "For therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old is gone and the new has come." Thus, as we come to this table, we realize that we're not in this battle alone. That the Holy Spirit of God trumps the law and is in us and causes us to walk with him each day. And as we walk with him, we are fortified and we're able to have victory. The third promise we see here is God's forgiveness. Psalm 32:5, it says, "I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgive the guilt of my sin." God says, "I will remember their sins no more." Forgiveness through God. But yet that doesn't mean that he forgets. He just doesn't choose to hold it against us. Because if he forgot, he would stop being God. But through that choice of his love to us and his forgiveness and all the terrible things that we've done against God over all the years, knowingly, especially, God says, "You know what? I still choose to forgive you. I still love you. We can work this out. Because I'm not giving up on you." He chooses to forgive us. It's a great verse. And the last thing we see here is the promise of eternal blessing. The old covenant was still governed under the nation of Israel when the epistle was written. And they were thinking, oh, what's the stuff he's talking about? We have the temple still. We have the law. And yet, little did they know that shortly after that, everything would be left. And that they would no longer have a temple. That the law would be seriously, seriously damaged. And that's when Paul says, you no longer need the law. You have something better. You have the Messiah, the one who has come. Hebrews 9:12 says, he did not enter by means of blood and goats and calves, but entered by the most holy place, once for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. The Greek word here for New Testament, new, is new in quality, not in time. New in quality, not in time. You know, as we come, and as I heard that song on the radio this week, one of my first thoughts was the Hope Diamond. I don't know if you've done any reading in regards to it, but a pretty massive jewel. It's on the screen. There it is. 45.52 carats. It's blue, appears blue to the naked eye. It's the size of a pigeon egg or good-sized chestnut. Someone said when they touched it, it felt cool. It has been stolen a couple times. It used to be 67.75, and somebody cut off some of it. So now it's only 45. I thought about this, and I thought, wow, that's a flaw, unflawed jewel. And yet, even with the Hope Diamond, if you look very, really close, there will be a flaw. In comparison to our salvation, there is no comparison. When I think of flawless, I think of the act of Christ on the cross. But I also think about the act of Christ in our lives. And if I were to hold up a big mirror here today and show it to all of you, I would say, look at all these flawless jewels in Christ. If you know Jesus as your Savior, you are flawless. There is no flaw in you because of Christ. So do not believe the lie of the evil one that says that you cannot come to this table this morning. Because it's not about you. It's about Jesus and his flawless act of love for you. So remember, when you go through your week, realize that you have a superior high priest who sits at the right hand of the Father, who intercedes for you, and no matter what you do, he will stand up for you. And through Christ, we have forgiveness for our sins. So I would invite you to come. I would invite you to come after I pray and hold the elements in your hands and we'll take them all together. And I would ask you to consider your relationship with the Lord right now. Maybe there's areas in your life that you need to confess. Now is the time. But remember, if you know Jesus, you don't have to ask for Jesus to come into your life again. That was done once for all. And that's a saving with our commitment to him. But there may be some house cleaning that needs to be done. And that's between you and the Lord. So after I take the elements, prepare them, I will sit down, and then I will invite you to come, take the elements, and hold them, and we'll take them together. God bless. What the law covered over, Jesus Christ took away. And thus, we have the opportunity to be able to take of this communion time in remembrance of him. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he broke it, he said, "This bread is my body broken for you. Eat it in memory of me." And so together we eat to Jesus Christ. With the thought that he will come back one day, that our eyes are to the sky waiting for Christ to come back. But until he does, he tells us that his covenant with us is new and is better, and that we live under a quality of life that we could not have on our own, but only through the blood of Christ. And thus it leads us to the cup, the new covenant, symbolically the blood shed for us on the cross. 20 years ago, people thought Christians were cannibalistic, they're eating people's blood, Jesus' blood. And yet we know it's a symbol. It's the cup that Christ gave for us. It was the covenant. You eat with somebody, you drink with them, you eat with them, it's a covenant. And so we are saying today that we are covenanting again with Christ. And it's the symbolic way that we will follow him wherever he leads us. And so we say to Jesus, let's drink. As is our usual custom, we're going to take an extra offering. It's called a benevolent offering. Some of you may have gotten an email in regards to a suggestion that we have, and that is that we have identified about 9 different families that could use some help in our church, and so we would like to be able to take an offering for them this time. And so this benevolent offering will go to those folks. If we get more than our suggested $450, then we'll use that for others, because we know already people are interested in help this Christmas season. So as the Lord leads you, we want to give this particular offering to those folks and help them out this Christmas season. So let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for this extra opportunity to share. And I pray that you'd open our hearts to whatever you want us to give, so that we can help those others in our church and possibly the community with a physical touch of you. So bless this offering, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.